On Facebook, Mark.
Okay, great. I will cut the tunes, and we're welcome everybody. We hopefully every week we learn a little bit on the technology, and hopefully this will be fun. And the first thing we're going to be doing is opening a bottle of wine. So. It'll make my presentation much better if you're drinking wine, I think. So I'm just going to go over it real quick again. Some people might not watch last week on opening. So everybody has the pen mat and the sec.
Mark?
Yes.
Can you stop sharing your screen so we can see you full screen opening it?
Yeah, thank you, Suzanne. That was the plan, and I do so... Okay. Is this now I think I'm good? Yes. Okay. So I'm going to open up the sec. You can choose whatever you'd like, and we're going to be talking about both wines. But talking about the sec again is making sure you always keep your hand or your tool over the top of this. And so I'm putting my thumb over it, unscrewing it. And since I don't have the sparkling wine stopper, I mean, I'm actually gonna go with a towel. And now I'm gonna open it, and I'm gonna actually turn the bottle, hold the cork, whoops, and there it goes. So the key part is we don't want flying corks, even though we might think it's fun to have a flying cork, but they are dangerous. So anyway, so we're also going to do a cheers. So I'm hoping everybody can get some wine. And we're going to do a virtual cheers here. And I think Suzanne's going to be trying to unmute everybody. Okay. Suzanne, are we good?
We are good. All unmuted.
Okay. All right. So, and the trying times, and definitely we want some health and happiness. And I hope we have a fun time here today, and have everybody has a great weekend. And cheers to everybody.
Cheers.
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 All right. So one of the things today, the person that everybody heard there a little bit is my sister Suzanne, who handles our social media marketing and advertising and does a lot of the correspondence. And so she's behind the scenes helping me out here. And so I'm going to start presenting about making it. And then we're going to, unlike last time, I'm going to find a space where we're going to ask questions about the presentation or about the processes that I'm going to be talking about. There's a chat room area that you can put questions in, because I will feed off of those. I'll look at those probably first. And then also don't hesitate to raise your hand and that, because also Suzanne will be trying to correspond with me on things that I need help on. So let me share my screen.
Okay, I'm gonna mute everybody. Oops, I'm gonna mute everybody now so that when Mark presents, we're not getting feedback, okay? And then I'll unmute you for the question and answer part. Sound good? Sorry, Mark, I had you muted as well.
Well, I can say that was my excuse for trying to find my slide. Okay. Let me get out of that. I'm sorry. I'm lost right now. Okay, I think everybody's, yes, I think we're good now. All right, so today, talking about the making it, I'm trying to get my laser pointer all set. I think everybody knows this week we're doing the ISC Pet and Sec, which I mentioned it, and the topic is making it. So, just quick review of the things I'm going to discuss is a little bit about sparkling wine versus carbonated wine. Fermentation, the creation of the bubble. So last week was all about the pressure, which this is kind of the beginning stages of it. And so we'll also be bringing up a little bit about the pressure in these slides. And then the different ways to make sparkling wine. And then we're going to be talking about champagne prosecco and a little bit of what were things on the United States scene and some federal government issues that I think people are interested in hearing. And then we're probably going to, well, the plan is to get into questions, and then we'll do finish off with tasting notes and more questions and whichever. So here we. So sparkling wine versus carbonated wine. So sparkling wine is using the fermentation process to create the bubbles. So the carbon dioxide are quote made through a natural process. That's what sparkling wine is, and to be able to use that term. And then carbonated wine is creating bubbles by injecting the CO2 into the wine. And this is basically a similar way on how a soda pop is carbonated. And also legally, carbonated wines cannot use the term sparkling wine on a label. So I say legally because if someone does not, they might say it's a sparkling wine, but potentially it's not. But legally, if it is a carbonated wine, it cannot have anywhere on the label, front or back, sparkling wine. So when you look at our August Hill Winery wines, you will not see anywhere on the labels sparkling wine. So we're going to go now a little bit in the making of sparkling wine. The carbonate, going back on carbonation real quickly, I'm probably not going to talk a whole lot more because it's a pretty simple process. So really, we're going to concentrate on the process of sparkling and how bubbles are created naturally. So we have fermentation. I want to, hopefully I put together some nice slides here on helping to understand fermentation. So in wine or in grapes, we harvest the grapes and we have in the grapes is sugar. And then we have, add some yeast. So my Pac-Man yeast are there with some oxygen and they will eat that sugar and it produces the wine, which the alcohol we like, as well as carbon dioxide, and the yeast are still there. So this carbon dioxide here is actually going into just the air, open air, and the yeast basically are no longer hungry because there's no more food and they die. And this, in what we call, in the winemaking process, this is the primary fermentation. And understanding this whole concept of fermentation is critical, or it helps people understand the process of making of sparkling wine and bubbles. So talking then specifically about sparkling wine, in most cases and talking the traditional method, but this here is my tank. Kind of looks like a fat bottle, which it kind of is, and it's also, you can say it's a closed vessel. So whether it's a bottle, whether it's a tank, we have wine in this vessel. And then we bring in and we actually add sugar to the wine. And then from there is we have the yeast coming in with a little bit of oxygen. And it actually, these yeast will eat that little bit of sugar that's in this vessel. And when we do this, is when we start off, is this pressure gauge up here is at zero. So there's absolutely no pressure. Well, as the yeast eat the sugar, we start to produce sparkling wine. And within this vessel is we have a little bit more alcohol. And we have some carbon dioxide. The yeast didn't go anywhere, but now there's no more food there, so they basically fall to the bottom of the bottle. And then if we look at our pressure on this bottle, and like I was talking about last week, is this is where now we have pressure in the bottle, all because of the yeast eating the sugar and making this carbon dioxide. So one thing here I want to add is, so like, say if I wanted to add a little bit more sugar, if I add a little bit more sugar than my original amount, is then you'll see is actually our pressure will actually go up. And so it's a critical point where I was talking about last week on the different forms on how to increase pressure. And I was talking about carbonated wines. Some of the tank fermented wines are at different pressure levels. The reason these wines are at different pressure levels is because the amount of sugar that was added at the beginning of the process is different. So less sugar means lower pressure, more sugar means higher pressure. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the different methods of processes of sparkling wine. So we have the ancestral method, which is the Petillant Naturel, which like in our label says Petnat. And this is the vessel, like I had just shown you, is the actual bottle. And then I'm going to be going through our traditional method, which is much of like, well, what our sec is that we'll be trying also today. And that's also fermented in the same bottle that we're drinking out of today. And then the third process that I'm not going to talk a ton about because it's basically what I just showed you, but I will talk a little bit more about it because, and that's the Charmat process, the tank fermented process, because I later on I'll be talking a little bit about Prosecco. But one of the big differences between when you ferment things, wherever you do that fermentation, even though you might kind of add the exact same amount of sugar, every vessel that the fermentation takes place in is actually going to be different. So if in the ancestral method and the traditional method of sparkling wines, technically every bottle, everybody has a bottle of Sec and everybody has a bottle of Pet Nat, and so do I. However, it's kind of like a snowflake. Those bottles aren't necessarily exactly the same because the fermentation happened in its own bottle. So your fermentation may be just a little bit different than how my fermentation handled because the yeast in there might be all the same strain and everything, but they're not all the same personalities. Now, when we talk about a Charmat process, which much of the Prosecco is in the tank fermented, thing about that is since everything is fermented in that tank, is when they go to bottle it, every bottle should basically be extremely consistent because there's nothing changing. It's kind of like bottling our still wines. All the bottles should be the same. The only difference potentially is like, you know, if using natural cork, does it get corked or some other extreme situation, or how the bottle is handled exteriorly. But if the two, if like on a still wine and a tank fermented wine, if two bottles are next to each other and stored exactly the same, they should basically taste exactly the same. So talking about the Pet Nats. Okay, I'm going back to the pictures I was showing you earlier on the primary fermentation. And so we have the yeast with the grapes and the sugar and with a little bit of oxygen. And before I showed you, it all produced wine carbon dioxide and the yeast were all dead. However, when we do the Pet Nat is we actually don't let the yeast die all the way and we don't let all the sugar go away. And basically off of this primary, during this primary fermentation at the very end, when there's a little bit of sugar, is that's where we actually decide to bottle it. So my next slide, I basically bringing the same picture that was on the right side that you just saw. And now we actually go into the bottle. And so with the, where we have the sparkling wine, a little bit of alcohol, the carbon dioxide, the yeast will die. And now we have pressure. And that's because of that sugar that the yeast ate. So it, that's how we get the pressure in a Pet Nat. This next slide here is from our bottling. So you can see us the bottles filling up with the yeast in it. And then this is laying in our cages as the wine is finishing fermentation. And then eventually the yeast will die and all the yeast will be sitting on their sides, on the side of the bottle before we release it. And Pet Nats are typical, well, we release it like just a couple months after we bottle it. So like right now we're looking at trying to release our Pet Nats November 1st and the grapes are coming in at the end of August. So literally the crazy part about this is the bottling and everything is happening during our crush season, which is which is a very critical point, and putting a lot of added work during a critical time period. But it's fun and it's unique. All right, so traditional method. This is something that you could see also similar on our website. I think we do a really good job on our website kind of showing a little bit of the process of this traditional method. I take a little step back because here some of our for a rosé. It's juice coming off our press. And we do a very delicate pressing, and then we do a very slow primary fermentation. And then after that primary fermentation is actually complete, is that's where we can, you could see in these glasses here, it's clear wines. And they're like, well, still wine, just like if you were to get Sauval or one of the wines, but with no sugar at this point. And we're coming up with what our blend is going to be that we're going to put into the bottle. And that blend will be different varieties of grapes, might be from different vineyards. And at times we can even go with different vintages. Then the next part is basically where we we're measuring out the yeast, but we add the yeast to the tank with sugar, and we bottle the wine into the bottles that like you have at home, like the sec is in. And then while it's fermenting, this is in the traditional method we call aging sur lot, and this is where it's just aging on its side and developing the flavors that help in utilizing for the traditional method, which typically the grapes we like to utilize in the traditional method is not necessarily overly aromatic because then the influence of the yeast during this aging process has a little bit more of a greater influence on the finished product. And then this is Sarah here, riddling. So no one likes yeast in their bottle, except when you're doing your pet nat and you have the yeast in the bottom of the bottle. But for the traditional method is you don't want the yeast in the bottle. So what we're trying to do is we're moving this yeast to the end of the bottle by riddling the bottle. And then once all the yeast gets to the end of the bottle, I think this is a pretty good picture we got here, this is the process called disgorging. So we're hand disgorging it here, and you can see right here is the yeast slug shooting out of the bottle. And here you can see some yeast too. So we shoot out that yeast and get a nice, so we can have clear wine. And so the next step is adding the dosage. But before I even talk about the dosage, you can see this bottle, which was just disgorged. And with the light, you can see it's crystal clear. I mean, it's a green bottle. However, it is, it's very clear. And so we were able to get all that yeast out. But after that disgorgement is where we can add a liquor, the dosage, into it. And it's just a unique blend on what, that gives the finishing touch on the wine, and also is what gives the sweetness in the wine. So, because before we add this dosage, this wine has no sugar on it, or because the yeast ate all the sugar. And so all the sweetness that comes into this wine, so for when we talk about our sec, we're sitting at 23 grams per liter of sugar. That sugar is all coming in with this dosage. And then once the dosage goes in, we do the corking and the caging with the wire cage and mixing it, the dosage in. So next, I'm just gonna touch base on a little bit about champagne. So champagne, the style is a traditional method, but technically they have they specifically call it method champenois. And this method has specific criteria within the region of Champagne that every producer within that region has to go by that method in order for them to even call it Champagne, let alone to use this method of terminology. So they have very strict methods in this. Champagne is a specific brand to that region of France. And here we can see that this is the country of France, and Paris is right where my highlighter is. And so Champagne region is about an hour to the east of Paris. I'm kind of getting confused on my directions here. But, and then these are just within the Champagne region, just different growing areas that they have. But the one thing I want to just say a little bit about Champagne is people kind of say Champagne is why can't I call it Champagne? I mean, that's the biggest thing is, you know, when someone calls it. And honestly, I don't think Champagne has that much of an issue in you saying the word Champagne in the use of sparkling wine. I believe their biggest issue is people writing the term Champagne on their bottles and basically using the word Champagne as their product. And one of the examples I kind of use, or at least I always use, is when I need a facial tissue, but I always say, hey, can you give me a Kleenex? You know, and obviously I feel people who might be trying to, or who call their wine Champagne, you know, if they were a facial tissue person and they're making it, they would probably put on their boxes Kleenex. However, Puffs, you know, doesn't use the word Kleenex, and they don't allow that term. But it has a similarity effect on that, and it's and part of, you know, yes, there's a lot of history to the use of the word Champagne, but that's the big issue I feel that Champagne has is actually the utilization of the writing of Champagne on bottles that are not from that region, where people are trying to use their term. Okay, so next I'm gonna talk a little bit about Prosecco. So what's interesting about Prosecco is Prosecco is made within a specific region of Italy. And it's mostly tank fermented sparkling wine. They there is some Proseccos that actually have is some traditional method made. But actually, Prosecco was named after Slovenian grape variety. And the variety name changed to Glera after the popularity of the use of the wine Prosecco. And so the region of Prosecco, which is up right near Venice here, in the northern part of Italy, actually was renamed in 2009, and using the grape term because they're already the popularity they're seeing in the wine, and basically they didn't want people to start using the Prosecco grape instead, because much of all that wine was coming from that region. They basically took a proprietorship where other people around the country technically can't use the term Prosecco. So it's a little interesting because Prosecco wasn't always a region. It was actually a grape variety. And it's rather recent. So a little bit about sparkling wine is you do see the term American Champagne. And this is the issue that I feel the producers in Champagne have with the use of what US is. But what's interesting was in 2006, The United States and European Union agreed to restricting the use of regional names of the terms. However, many wineries were grandfathered wineries, and so they could still utilize the term champagne. And what I understood, what kind of drove this agreement, was because my understanding is there was a winery that was not in the United States, and they actually started to call their wine Napa Valley, and obviously the people from Napa Valley did not like that. And then that's where the European Union kind of got involved and said, hey, you know, you've been using our terms of our regions all this time and everything. And how can you now say people can't use Napa Valley when you've been utilizing ours? So that was kind of the instinct that kind of started a bit of this. But in the U.S., there's many styles of sparkling wines, but legally, they need to all be naturally fermented. So that's the critical part of the sparkling wine. And so that's kind of my quick rundown of sparkling wine. And right now, as I hope you still are sipping on some wine, and before we go into some of the tasting notes, I wanted to open up to some questions. So I'm gonna do better this time. There, I'm opening it up to so you can see me and throw me some questions. Okay, Kelly, I see you raise your hand. You go ahead.
Yes. For the Pet Nat, are there certain grapes that are better than others?
That's a great question. I feel that the Pet Nat is technically the oldest method of making sparkling wine, hence called the ancestral method. However, a lot of this style of wine has not been made a lot. There's been a decent amount made from France. And so just like what we're doing from all our grapes in Illinois, from making still wines to sparkling wines, we're learning. So what we're seeing is we really like the Chambersin grape, which obviously is the rosé that everybody has. We did our first Chardonnay this year, and that's the Il Natic that we did a small batch of that we're almost all out of. And we think that works really well. One of the critical points, though, with using our grapes in the Pet Nat process is these wines are bone dry, because basically we're bottling it at the end of fermentation, and we're never going to disgorge it, and we're not adding a dosage. So it's all from the natural fermentation. So you also are going to be limited on what grapes potentially have a acidity balance that isn't too acidic, where which nice acid helps us in sweet wines because it creates a nice balance in the wine. However, since the Pet Nat is totally dry, you need something that's going to be lower in acid. So that kind of limits us a little bit on our varieties. But we're seeing, so the Chardonnay I'm liking, the Chambersin. And I think if we can get some Vignol this year, we're thinking about trying some Vignol. I think that could be a great potential. And I'm sure there's some other varieties, but those are the ones that I'm thinking of.
Awesome.
All right. The other questions? Suzanne, are you seeing any questions before I move on to the tasting notes?
Yes, someone has. How long does it usually take to ferment the wine?
Oh, that's a great question. So how long does it take to ferment a wine? Depends, but typically for sparkling wine in the bottle, we're seeing about 1 month on average. Primary fermentation, when we're talking about just when we're controlling the temperature in a tank, typically we're seeing about 2 weeks for our fermentations. However, definitely every winemaker has their styles. They can do extended fermentation, and also they could do quicker fermentations too. But typically our primary fermentation is roughly around 2 weeks. But fermentation in the bottle, we're seeing it's close to a month. And you might want to, so how we test it, because the thing during primary fermentation, we can check with the hydrometer and watch the sugar levels during the fermentation, then basically when the fermentation stops. So we're checking it twice a day, the fermentation. So it's very easy to do it. However, in sparkling wine, you know, we don't want to be opening bottles every time and then there's bubbles in it and it just create a mess on doing it. So the way we actually test when a fermentation is done is we have a pressure gauge that we can stick into through the cork or the cap, and it fastens to the top of the bottle, and we monitor that pressure. And actually, you know, we always talk about never shake a bottle before you open it. Well, actually, when we're trying to measure the pressure, is we're trying to get the CO2 out of solution. So we'll put our pressure gauge on and we'll just shake the heck out of it and see where the pressure's at. And so like on a champagne, based off our sugar levels, we're expecting to get about 6 atmospheres of pressure. So if we shake it and we see that we're at 5 atmospheres of pressure, then we basically say, hey, well, we're not done. But then when we get up closer to that 6.2 on the pressure, we will monitor and see if it's holding there, and hopefully we didn't add too much sugar, because if you add too much sugar, then our pressures are going even higher.
Okay, Mark, we have another question from Amanda. Why are some bottles colored and some clear?
Oh, great question. So the thing about using the green bottles, is light is a critical area, is a critical sensitivity on all wine. And especially on the champagne and the traditional method that's meant to be aging so in our cellars, it's very dark. So that's why much of champagne and sparkling wines are typically in green. Not saying you can't put it in clear bottles, because you do see some very nice wines with in a clear bottle. And so we chose to put Pet Nat in a clear bottle. And part of the main reason on that is Pet Nat is meant to be consumed early and young, where, you know, the traditional method, you know, we're aging it in our caves for, you know, anywhere from 2 years to five. I mean, well, the ensemble that everybody will be having, or not the ISC pack, was about 5 years, I think. And then we do have some that's in the cellar that's sitting at 10 years. So, and we're really excited to introduce those someday. But if it was in a clear bottle, there'd be a little bit greater risk. And so right now we definitely want to be concentrating on trying to make the best wine and understanding the limitations of that. So we're minimizing the use of clear glass right now.
Okay, another question, Mark. When you release the plug of yeast, do you lose a lot of the wine from the bottle?
Great question. So when we do that disgorging of the bottle, no, we don't. So what's kind of interesting is I'm gonna give a little demonstration here, even though it's in my bottle, but on every bottle there's gonna be some gas. And the picture I showed you, where I thought was a nice picture showing the yeast, was the bottle was turned upside down. So when you release the cap on a bottle upside down, the pressure, the gas pressure back here is actually pushing the wine out. So you have a lot of loss. However, when we do our disgorging on our line, is we actually freeze the neck. So it sits at really, really cold temperature, and it's like an ice cube up here. So then we can turn the bottle right side up, and then we have gas between our ice slug. And so when we release that cap, is the thing that pushes out is the gas, because the gas is what wants to escape first. So we actually lose very little. And typically we, because we have to add liquid sugar to create a dosage, is typically we have to take wine out of the bottle to fit the dosage in.
Hmm. Okay, another question. Does a drier wine take more yeast and less sugar?
More yeast and less sugar. Okay. Does a drier wine take, say that again, Suzanne?
Does a drier wine take more yeast and less sugar? So maybe you need to explain how sometimes the sugar is added in the dosage.
Yeah. So the amount of yeast added to each bottle is pretty consistent, because so the wine, before we start adding any sugar, all the wines are dry that are going to be made into sparkling, except the Pet Nat. The Pet Nat, we have to have a certain amount of sugar. So all the wines are dry. And so for us to get 6 atmospheres of pressure, we have to add 24 grams per liter of sugar. So we were adding the exact same amount of sugar, whether the because all the wines are dry. And then as far as the yeast is concerned, is depending on the batch, but pretty much for the most part, all the yeast are very identical, not too much off. And we've been learning and playing around with this a little bit, because like I was showing you earlier a little bit, is after riddling, is we'll get our yeast build up in the bottle. And, you know, and if we add too much yeast to start with, we could have too much yeast here. And if we have too much yeast here, it creates problems during disgorging process. So we've kind of been trying to learn more about our grape varieties as well as yeast, because yeast don't also react the same way with every type of wine variety. So the answer is we kind of use the similar amount of yeast, but every variety does have some variability to it. I hope that answered the question.
And you might want to add that a sweeter wine like Demi-Sec gets its sweetness when you add the dosage.
Yes. So just like the sec is a little bit drier than the demi-sec, and the demi-sec is the sweetest, but the amount of sugar that goes into the demi-sec is going to be a lot more than what's in the sec. But there's more sugar in the sec than what's in the brut. And that, because all the sugar is coming in with that dosage.
And one more question. How does temperature affect fermentation?
That's a great question. So yeast like warmer environments. So if you put it into a warm environment, the fermentation will go faster. So I'm kind of saying, like, if you're in an environment of 70, 80 degrees, that yeast is going to chug along and work really quickly. However, if you go a little bit cooler, the yeast will go slower. Well, the good thing about when yeast goes slower is they kind of work like the turtle, or it's like you work at a slow pace, and you just keep it going and you chugging along, you potentially have a better opportunity to make it all the way to the end when you're at a good pace. Instead, if you like warm up and you try to go real fast, sometimes you don't finish all the way. And so we ferment ours right at in the cave. So we're sitting at 60 degrees. So we're fermenting cool and rather slow. But like I mentioned, we monitor our pressure with that pressure gauge. Well, if we're sitting at a fermentation and it's like at, you know, 3 atmospheres of pressure, it's like, oh, this is going too slow, or it's like, this should be going a little bit faster. Well, what we do is we can pull it and put it in a different part of the winery and maybe even put some heaters around in that room and warm up the room. So then that fermentation might be able to speed up a little bit. So temperature has a huge effect. And so it's also a tool to help us out at times if something seems like it's struggling. Any more questions? All right, then I'm going to talk about the pet nat. And so if you haven't opened up the pet nat yet, it's like having two different wines, the pet nat. Is if you open up the pet nat and you pour the glass that is totally clear. So I have a cold bottle here. And so the pet nat has yeast in it. I'm going to talk about in a little bit too. But anyway, it has yeast at the bottom. But if you try this wine, and so if you get, so let me open mine. And if you guys want to open it, is try it. But this wine tastes different without the yeast than it does with the yeast. And I think it's fun. Raise your hand if you're able to do this, or is your yeast all mixed in? So right now I have a clear glass, and I think you can see that's really clear. But now I'm gonna put the fancy sparkling wine stopper on it. Oops. And be careful, because this is going to create pressure, but you could see the yeast starting to come down here on me. So now I'm still clear so far, and I'm going to mix it, get that going. And so I'm building pressure in this bottle. So you have to be careful. Make sure your tip, the end is on, or else I'm going to create a mess here. And so now my bottle totally looks different. And so, okay. So I just opened it. And so now I have a glass like this. So let me... I need a third hand. Okay. So now I have my two glasses from the exact same bottle. And what's fun on this is so this is made from the Chamberson grape. And the clear one is typically, for what I notice, is you're going to see more of the acidity. And when you taste the one with the yeast actually cover the palate a little bit, and it gives a perception of sweetness. And so even though there's no sugar in here, is actually the yeast actually influence your palate, and it basically counters the acid in the wine. I don't know if people are able to try that. So I'm gonna taste it though. So again, this is 2019 vintage. So this is nice Christmas crispness, and you know, sparkling wine drinkers love acidity. They embrace the acidity because it goes so good with bubbles. But then with the yeast, It just coats the palate. And that's what also kind of what sugar does. And so it kind of gives a perception of sweetness. One might say it's slightly sweet, but it actually isn't. It's just the different of the yeast in there. Any questions? I'm going to open up any questions on the pet nat before I go to the sec. Does anybody have any questions on the pet nat?
Right. Agree. And I honestly believe it has everything to do with the parents.
All right. How about a thumbs up on, or you can even put a yes if you really like it, or a no, it's not your favorite. Oh yeah, it works. Okay. So there you go. Anyway, okay. Now I'm gonna go to the sec. So the sec is actually it comes from our vineyard. It's the Le Crescent grape, which is made out of coming from Minnesota. That's where the grape was developed, out of the University of Minnesota. But we grow these grapes in our vineyard. It's actually from the 2016 vintage, as everybody can see. And what else does it say? It was tirage bottled, so it was bottled in January of 2017, and we just disgorged it this past February. So that at least my bottle says that. And so basically this has been sitting on Lee's 3 years. Oh, that's what I had poured the cheers with. So I have this up on the board here. I always love the bubbles. I fascinate on bubbles. So the Le Crescent, of all our traditional methods, sparkling wines, it has the most aromatics. Le Crescent has quite a bit of aromatics. It definitely has a little bit of sweetness on the palate, but not, I wouldn't necessarily consider it a sweet wine. It definitely has, with the acidity, it definitely helps make the wine flow. And compared to our carbonated wines within August Hill Winery, I'd consider it more similar to a semi-dry, semi-sweet, similar to our Vignol, I would say, on sweetness level. You know, it definitely has that fruitiness up front on it. I always called this, when we made it, similar to the Prosecco style, because I kind of feel Proseccos are more fruitier, lighter. The one thing that when we work on this wine, we call it creating a poof effect on this wine, is we like where the sugar comes across the palate, but it kind of lifts off the palate, and we call it the poof effect. That's our own internal terminology that we use in our winery of creating a poof effect on the wine, and with this fruitiness. But it's a style that enjoy with a little bit of, that has a little sweetness. I don't know if there's any other significant notes on this wine. So this is our, like within our sparkling wine categories, we have a number of brutes. So after our brut, this would be our next sweetest. And then the only thing that's sweeter than this is the demi-sec rosé. Any questions on this?
There's a question. Are you able to produce all year long, or is there a main season only when the grapes are available?
So grapes only produce one time a year. So for us in the United States, if you saw the beginning pictures, is we're just coming into bud break. Just like in Illinois, much of the trees are just starting to come out. So that's what's happening in our vineyard. and then the fruit, we'll start to actually see the clusters of grapes in about 3 or 4 weeks. At least the formation that we'll see the flowers, but our harvest is going to be starting in August typically and finishing in October every year.
Another question, how soon do you need to start making wine after harvesting the grapes, and do the sugars in the grapes then change over time before crushing?
As soon as the grapes are harvested, it's critical that we start to process them as quickly as possible. In our methods, and what we do is we are looking to crush and get the fermentations going rather quickly. There's definitely wineries in California, for example, that are doing reds and they're doing extended macerations where they'll crush the grapes and they'll let the skin sit there and everything. We're not doing that. So when the grapes are harvested, usually within a couple of days, if not the same day, that we're already starting to process the grapes, getting to juice, or if it's a red wine, we're crushing them so we can get the color. And we're starting that fermentation process right away, because once the grapes are picked, bacteria that might be coming from the vineyard, or like just even a gnat that might be in the vineyard could put the vinegar bacteria out there, and so you don't want to let things just sit around. You want to make sure that you can get them protected. But once you can get that fermentation going, that the yeast cell are going to be protecting the wine. The wine is going to, the most sensitive time for the whole winemaking period is in that juice phase, for juice, until we start getting that fermentation going. Just because we're not made really to hold juice for an extended period of time. We're looking to hold it as wine. And once it's as a wine, we have preservatives in it, which is the key preservative is the alcohol. So yeah, do you think that answered the question, Suzanne?
Yeah.
Good girl.
Okay. Are there any other questions? No. So I next week we will be will be the last week, and I'm going to be talking about bubble nucleation. So might be thinking your head's kind of got busted with all this pressure last week with pressure. Obviously, talk about making it today, but next week is we're going to dig down a little bit on looking at these bubbles, and then, you know what, why are these bubbles happening in that? So I'm looking forward to hopefully we can have an enjoyable the last session on this, and we're going to be coming up with some more ideas of some other things. And thank you guys all for joining. And oh yeah, I saw the pizza there. Making sure the carry out, I need to order. So thank you for reminding on that. So that's good. So hope everybody's doing the carry out, and hopefully everybody's well. We're looking forward to hopefully getting open at some point sooner than later. But the key part is that everybody's staying safe and we're all doing well. So enjoy and cheers.
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 Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.